All the pikes I remember the most are the ones I've caught on the popper. To see a big pike attack one of these poppers is just awesome. Truly amazing. The thing that comes that is closest to my heart is fishing with these poppers. It's just spectacular in every way. You see the pike come from maybe 2-3 meters away with their fins just blazing through the water, just foaming it up and just grabbing your big bait, and that is just awesome.
Hi there and welcome. Thank you for tuning in. So I just started off now here with a small clip. I wanted to make this a bit different and something that stood a bit out. Hi to everyone. I can see the chat is going very well. I'm happy to see that. And first of all, what I really want to say is, can you please check if everything is okay? Is my audible? Is the audio? Is that okay? Is the picture quality okay? I have the setup here with one camera where I can speak directly to you, and another one here that is basically showing the fly I'm going to tie, the hook with the fly I'm going to tie in a second. So could you please comment if everything is up to standard, and if you think things sounds and looks okay? That would be very great. There is some latency here, so whenever I say something, it takes about 8 or 6 seconds, something like that, before I can actually see a response. So so I'm looking forward to that. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to open this beer, if I have something to open it with. And then I hope to hear a lot of comment that that thing is... Oh, crap. How about now? Is it better now? Is that better? Yeah, I know it all went black there for a second. I'm sorry about that. I'm terrible. Sorry about that. I think that's probably something. Yeah, Black Friday, of course. But it has something to do with me trying out a bit of different new stuff. I should probably just have kept it safe, but you know. So everything is fine. Okay. I think probably I need to do this. Good. Okay. Very well. Then welcome everyone. I'm happy to be doing this again. It's fun being here, and I hope you're going to enjoy this. The way we're going to do this is, first up, there's going to be two different flies today. There's going to be one that's a trout flies. There's an echo now again. Oh my god. I think it's better now. So, basically what I was... Yeah, it's because for some reason my system tells me I have four different microphones. I don't know why. I don't think that's even possible. But what I was saying, I think it's probably better now. Yeah, okay, good. What I was saying was I'm going to do two different flies today. First up, because I want these live stream sessions to be divided into two parts. So it's going to basically be a trout fly tying session. That's the first half hour, or what's left of this first half hour. And then a predator fly tying session, you know, a pike, bass, whatever you want, musky, stuff like that, the second part. So first up is I'm going to tie a nymph now. And hello to everyone. It's nice. It's really nice to see you, or at least to see you out in the chat. I'll try to do the best I can with the chat here. But you know, I'm gonna be doing a lot of stuff with tying and keeping track of my beer. Cheers, everyone. If you haven't got a beer, then go get some. That depends, of course, on what your time zone is. I think probably something like that. Greetings from Canada. Perch for the win. Yeah, we're going to do some perch flies as well, of course. Well, basically, I'm going to start with this. This is a very nice fly. I've been using a lot, and this is actually my most efficient and best go-to and best go-to nymph of all times. I talked to someone yesterday who told me that it probably would be a very good idea if I in advance showed in what order I was going to use the materials. So first up we have the hook, then I'm going to use a gold head, then I'm going to use two different colors of dubbing. This is some squirrel dubbing, so I'm going to use some green, and then some brownish ones. And also, I messed up that order completely. I'm going to use some flash, and some partridge. Icarus back. God damn it. That is really annoying with that echo. It should be gone now again. So basically, I take my hook here, and then I attach one of these gold heads. And I should never have done anything. I should just have kept let the system decide. I'm gonna take this one out, like so. Probably something is. Yeah. Okay. So basically, I take my gold head here, and a gold head has two different points of entry. It has a small diameter hole and a bigger diameter hole, and I put the hook into the smaller diameter hole. That means I have the larger diameter hole to cover up materials and stuff like that here. So basically, there you go. Gonna attach that nice and easy, and then I'm gonna get some tying thread here. I'm gonna do some tying thread all the way down here, and actually this nymph, as I said, this is my go-to nymph. It's one of the best nymphs I ever fished. Echo is better. One of the best nymphs I ever fished, and actually this was something I saw very long time ago in a fishing magazine, where I was a young and hopeful fly fisherman who was going here. Which is a nice picture of a very nice brown trout I caught in New Zealand, and so I studied a lot and read a lot about different fly patterns and stuff like that, and you know, I spent almost half a year building two different boxes, and I think I had about 1500 flies I brought to New Zealand, and you know, as always, you end up with having boxes just completely stuffed when you're going on your adventures and stuff like that, but I had so many flies, it was unbelievable. And still, one of the first flies I put on the leader when I got down to New Zealand and actually got to some place where there was some fish to catch was this one, and it barely left the leader unless I was fishing with a dry fly afterwards. And that's simply, you should get Snapchat. Yeah, probably you're right, Casper, about Snapchat. I don't know that that thing, but as I was saying, I took some flesh here, and this is some copper flesh. This is actually fleshaboo in copper with some marks on it. It's called I can't really recall speckled flesh, and I'd take about maybe something like 6 or 7 strands, something like that. But I was fishing down in New Zealand, and as always, you know, when you get into a new place, you have a million bazillion different flies because you want to have something for every single situation. So I had cicadas, I had nymphs, I had simply just an insane amount of different flies. And as I was saying, you know, I tied this onto to the leader and hooked the first fish with this one. And then simply after that, it was just, you know, this fly was just going. So basically, I ended up tying in the car when we were driving from place to place, because we always were in short supply of these. And one of the things I learned about a trip like that to New Zealand was, as you can see, I'm just tying these down right here, is that one of the most important things when you take on adventures like that is, at least for trout fishing, when trout fishing concerned, then it's not important to have a lot of insanely a lot of different patterns, but what can often be very, very crucial to your success or your failure is that you have different type of flies with different weights on them. So we ended up having these without any weight added. Then we had it with simple regular gold heads, and then we had them with tungsten, because you were able to fish on fish that was feeding in different zones of the rivers. So basically that was a very important lesson. So if you're going trout fishing in uncharted waters, bring the nymphs, because, you know, this is a caddis nymph, a free swimming caddis nymph. Bring the nymphs you're used to from back home, because there's in all likelihood some of these insects is going to be the same, but bring different sizes and bring different weights on them. So some different sizes and then some differing weighting on them. Now I took some olive dubbing here, and it's important that you get this part right, because you want this fly to look good. I've taken a fairly large hook. This is a size 6. This is a Chimco 2457, a very nice hook. And what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna build up the body of this fly, and just gonna let all this hang, because this is gonna be kind of like part of the body here. But it's crucial that you taper the body, so you use a slightly more dubbing the further up the hook shank you get. So it's thin down where you start, and then it gradually becomes thicker and thicker and thicker. It's tapering. How is my English, by the way? And is everyone having fun? Do you agree with my selection of flies? You know, I've thought, given it a lot of. I really would like to see you comment on this. I've given it a lot of thought about how I could optimize and you know, get as much. Give you as much good as many good experiences and as usable flies as possible with this, and that's why I've decided to go with trout flies and predator flies, because a lot of guys out there likes my pike videos, kind of like the one I started with. As you can see, now I'm building it, so it's gonna gradually become thicker up here. And I think that I've done too few trout flies, so that's something I'm gonna rectify with this. I'm gonna go more into this whole trout fly scene, because I fish a lot of trout, and basically, let's face it, there is a lot of trout fishermen out there. So your English is fine. Not too bad. Ja, nu kan jeg lige snakke lidt dansk, så kan I høre det. Kan jeg også, men ja. I'm very pleased, and I'm immensely pleased that my English is passing this test. I'm glad to hear that, because, you know, it's not in any way my native language, and I never did a lot of. I'm just gonna have a cheers, everyone. I just like to you know, speak English, so basically I just did a lot. My written English is, well, not appalling, but it's generally not as good, basically not as good as my spoken English. In 10th grade, I got the second lowest grade in English writing, but I got the highest grade in speaking English. So that was. My English teacher said she had never given a so diverse and different and different character and different marks in one exam to any student before. You know, the span was just immense. Like so. Oh, I didn't show you. I'm sorry. I took the flesh here and then I turned it all over here, the body here. All of them except for one strand, because I need this one, because I want this to be kind of like that narrow. There is a small band of flesh lying here on top of the fly, and then I lift this one strand in order to have something to rip this fly with, so to make a ribbing up here. So that's I'm gonna use this the last flesh strand here to make a rib. Is it called ribbing? Rib, ribbing, rib, rib, rib. Like that. I'm gonna cut this off. So you see, now I have on top here, I have a broader band of copper flesh. Then I have about 3 or 4 turns of flesh to hold this copper in place, and also to hold the hackle in place. And basically, that's it. Next up is this. This is a partridge. You can buy a lot of different. You can buy a. Is I hope it's not doubling now. It should not be doubling. You can buy a lot of packages with loose partridge feathers. But one thing I really, really would like to stress is that if you get a complete partridge skin, you will get a lot better quality. You will get a lot better quality materials, and you can simply just pick and choose any of these that you like. So if you're an avid trout fisherman and or some sea trout fisherman or whatever, you will probably be using a lot of partridge feathers, and to get a full skin is simply something I highly, highly recommend. Okay, back to this. So I'm gonna take a feather here. I want a feather that does not have too long hackle fibers, because if it has too long hackle fibers, then my fly is gonna be out of proportion. So I simply take a nice little feather here. A nice little feather. It was really nice yesterday. Ribbed. Yes, ribbing. Sneaky baits fishing adventure. Oh, we're up to 46 now. That's actually pretty decent. So hello there, everyone. I saw there was a lot of different nationalities, and I think that is really, really great, because what I would like to do here is kind of build something that's kind of like a small community where, well, for instance, don't think we're gonna be, you know, personally acquainted or stuff like that, but at least to create something where you can all sit back and have fun, and you know. It's Friday night, so you can have a beer. I'm gonna have one, and simply just, you know, tie along if you want, but tie anything else if you don't, and simply just, you know, enjoy and have a good time. I'm gonna do everything I can to entertain you. That's, well, basically my humble commitment for this evening. Tell you a lot of stories, a lot of true stories, of course. All my stories are true, and hopefully tie some cool flies as well. Yes, Barry, we're gonna have beer. At least one. So, back to tying more. As I was saying, I carefully selected the feather that I wanted, and then I pulled off all the woolly stuff down here in the bottom of the feather, and then I gently take the feather here and I pull. Actually, this feather here is not good, because there was some destroyed ends to the hackle tips here, and I didn't want that. I'm gonna take a new one. Again, I strip off this bottom part here, like so. And basically, what I do is I take here and then I carefully fold all the feathers, all the fibers. I don't know what they called those fibers that is attached to the hackle here. Are they simply just called hackle fibers, or do they have a specific name? Well, hello, Mike, and Augustus. Corona, yeah, Corona is nice, you know. That was what I had in the freezer. We tried something new this week, where we simply just, you know, bought from a grocery from a supermarket, and they were supposed to deliver, and they didn't deliver until 3 days after. They were supposed to deliver on Friday, and the stuff only got there on Sunday, so we didn't have to pay, and we got a lot of free stuff, but the meat and stuff like that was not that great to smell. So, yeah. They're just called fibers. Okay, thank you, Carl. Carl, that's a nice name. My kid is called Carl. His name Carl. So I tied this down. I put
probably was a bit too fast there, too hasty. What I did, as you can see here, is I simply, oh, you can't see that, I simply took here the feather and I folded all these feathers back. Then I took it and tied it down on top with the most colorful, the top side pointing upwards. Because in a second when I'm gonna turn this, then all the fibers here is gonna be positioned correctly. Like so. And now I need my hackle pliers. And if you do not know this, then you should, because there is just some things that are just beyond cool. And the CF Design hackle plier is without a doubt one of these items, one of the items that you simply, once you tried one, you will never, ever, never, ever, ever go back. This is simply just the best tool there is on the market, period. Nothing compares to this one. And all the times you've tried when your hackle slips out of the hackle plier and stuff like this, you will never have experienced that with this one. So basically, I just turn my hackle here. And this is can be a bit brittle. So of course, be a bit careful when you turn this, like so. And I think that is about the correct amount of, and here you'll see in a second why it's important that you pick the correct size of feathers, because otherwise then these are going to imitate legs, and if you take a too big a feather, then these legs are going to look completely out of place and completely too big, and that's going to basically ruin the overall awesomeness of this fly, because this actually is a fairly easy fly, but it really is awesome. So basically, do I have something quite black? You see? Ah, I should have brought the camera in closer. Can I do that now? Is that better? I hope it is. Well, I had the camera a bit further away before. What dubbing did he use? I'm using Olive and Gray Squirrel, SLF Squirrel dubbing. A very, very neat product. This right here. Oh, and of course, it's too light, so. This is the stuff. Really, this is the stuff. So. Back to what matters here. So I'm gonna take some squirrel dubbing again, but this time I'm gonna take it in gray to make the front part of this fly. If you really want this to look completely awesome and stuff like that, you can take. Let's do that. Why not? You can take some pheasant tail here. Just take a single strand of this. Of course, two strands of this, like this. And then I'm gonna tie these so they're pointing. This is not a crucial detail, but it will look cool. I'm tying one so it's sticking out and fairly long, because actually these caddis nymphs here, they have these antennae, you know. So basically, you can see here, I've taking these two and tied them so they're sticking out in the back here. Basically, this is just for show. Of course, a child will probably be able to see them, but you know, in a fast-moving current where things are swimming by the trout quite rapidly, I'm not sure this is going to be the deciding factor if you catch a trout or no. But, you know, it looks good in the fly box, and the flies you end up fishing with is almost always the flies that look the best. It's very, very seldom that you pick out the fly you think the least of and that looks the ugliest to put on your leader. Basically, that's probably only when you probably only do that when you want to make a point. So what I did was I took some of the gray SLF squirrel dubbing. I can see there for some reason there was some flash mixed into this. I think it's from an old batch, and I simply just put some on the thread here. And when you do this, it's important that you. It's quite hot here. I'm just gonna adjust this camera here. It's quite important that when you stick this on there that you go the
completely the same way all the time. So you add it to the thread here, and then you really clamp down on it and mush it down, and then go all the way from the tip of the finger, and then all the way to the tip, and then back again. You can of course use some dubbing wax and stuff like that, and that generally increase and makes this process quite a lot easier. But you know, I've actually never been using that a lot. I simply just, you know, stick some on there and apply some good old ink grease or whatever you want to call it, like so, a bit more. Again, make sure that it tapers, so that you have a fly that is, and here it should of course taper the other way, so it should be thicker, close to your antennae and the hackle, and then it should gradually taper up until to the head, so stuff head horns. Yeah, you could call them horns, of course. Squirrel belly button fluff, that's completely correct, Duncan. You can use hair dubbing as well, and any, you know, anything that has that has some coarse larger hairs in that is great. Any natural dubbing. Then I'm gonna do it with finish, like that, and then basically the fly is finished. You don't need to apply varnish and stuff like that here, because actually here you have the gold head up front here to actually take the brunt force of most of the beatings from trout teeth that this one will endure, because trust me, this one will endure a lot of trout teeth. This is without a doubt my go-to most favorite trout nymph in the entire world. And for those of you that didn't see, I just want to flash that one more time. That was simply just a sweet, sweet, sweet ass fish. Really, really a sweet, sweet, sweet fish. Actually, there's a cool story about this, but I think I'm gonna you can get that another time. What I want to do now is I can see that we're a bit in front of schedule. There's a couple of minutes until I'm gonna start with the other one. So I think a good idea one was asking about is to take, let's say, the next 4 or 5 minutes or so to actually answer questions. So if you have any questions regarding this fly tying or regarding, yeah, I would say let's keep it to regarding fly fishing. I'm not an expert on much else. Do not tell that to my students, by the way. But I really would love to discuss and to talk about anything, because I think we're off to a good start now, and I think 5 minutes here in the end would be cool to actually discuss and talk about whatever you want to talk about. Then I'll just change this stuff and get ready for the next one. This turned out pretty well, and as I said, deadly, deadly, deadly. Yeah, Carla, I agree with you. I really, really like the squirrel dubbing as well. Well, lab once or something. I've been tying flies since I was 14, so about 20 years. I've never tried Tenkara. No, David. I must say that's an experience I have yet to try. But that could be fun. I've seen quite a few videos, and it actually looks kind of fun. If you want to start, I hope that answers the question, Sebastian. If you want to start fly tying, then send me an email or contact me via Facebook. My name is Daniel D. Holm. I can send you a link to my Facebook here, and I will be sure to send you a link to some different stuff that you can get to start tying. So here is a link to my Facebook, and just send me a friend request, or even better, send me a message. Then we can talk about it.
Um,
I'm not sure the hvor er ribben hashtag hvor er ribben should I think it's going to be a thing, but a thing between, you know, us that tie flies on Thursdays probably. Yeah, well, otherwise I think what we should do now is of course remember to take a swig of the beer. I've forgotten the lime. You know, it's still a very nice beer, this Corona. It's very light and easy, and I like these. Sometimes these are good, and sometimes I want something darker and more powerful, but for this I find these are quite soothing. Pike fishing from a SUP. I have no idea what an SUP is. Oh, I have a lot of favorite fly tires. I must say there is. I normally say I like to tie flies, but I'm nowhere near as good as many cool people are. I like Dave McPhail very much. The level of skill that he expresses on every single fly pattern he touches, it's just awesome. I like his videos as well, although he mumbles quite a lot and is a bit difficult to hear. I think that what he does is simply just outrageous and just insanely cool. Then there is a Danish guy called Kern, who ties the best shrimps I ever seen. Niklas Bauer has done some very, very cool stuff with the pike scene. Also Anderson, I can't recall his name, he ties some awesome poppers and some really insane. He's a Swede. He ties some really, really insanely nice pike and popper flies with deer hair, which really is cool. And the list is long. I like Holger Lachmann as well, and the guy who has the one fly block is really, really cool also. So there is Nils Folmer Jørgensen from Iceland is also someone that I really, really look up to. Dave is awesome. What is your favorite fly out of all the flies you've tied? Well, if I could only pick one to fish for all the different types of fish that I would like to target, then it would have to be a black woolly bugger, because woolly buggers in big sizes can catch anything that swims, really. Trout, sea salmon, pikes, grayling, perch, it's simply just a completely classic uniform pattern for something that looks like food that fish will eat. So, yeah, Hans Weilmann. Andreas Andersen, yeah, precisely, and Hans Weilmann, exactly. Those two are really, really legendary fly tires as well. So there is a lot of very, very skilled and very, very cool cool fly tires out there. I do not even try to compare myself to those. I have nowhere near their skill level. But what I think I have is me. I have some good ideas and I like to talk and I like to mess about. So basically I do what I does best. But probably you're gonna see some of these in these live sessions that sometimes things will go wrong. Of course they will, because there's no do over in this live thing, and I think basically that's also kind of the charm. I've left out the ribbing two times on the Danish live streams, and that's why people are talking a lot about the rib, because, you know, that was a thing. So Guinness beer is also nice, Dave. Yeah, I have enthusiasm. I get that quite a lot, but yeah, you know, I really enjoy things like that, and having people showing up and watching me tie is really, really awesome as well. So basically, let's move on to tie this next fly. And this next fly is quite a lot different than the other one. This is a big one. This is basically it's something that I've done quite a lot, and it's the color I use the most. This is a big black pike fly, and black is. For a long time I didn't use black flies, but then suddenly I tried them, and then it seemed that black was simply just simply just outperforming every single other fly that I had in my box. So now I use a lot of black, and I would say it like this: I have a lot of different pike patterns, and I'm not very very. I do not go into specific patterns very much. There's a lot of different materials that I like to use for my pike flies because I think they're very cool. But you know, to have specific patterns is not something that I really take too much care about. You need to build the pike flies correctly, and you need to build them in a certain way in order for them to swim in a good way. But you know exactly how much you use of this and how much of you use of that is not really necessary. I could show you my bobbin. It's this one. It's the new Chemco, but without the magnetic system, because I got one of the magnetic systems as well, but I could not get that to work. So basically, I retired that, and then tried some of the others. And what this basically is, it's basically one of them. It's fairly expensive for its kind of easy and very very simple design. But it really really fits nice into your hands. There is not any strange stuff that is just added there to add bling, to make it more complicated than it needs to be. It's simply just a very very nice, very solid, very good and perfect bobbin, I think, in my book. So the other, the old Chemco, I've used for years and years and years and years, and I really love that as well. So I think that simple is better when it comes to bobbins. Thank you, Rasmus. I'm tying in the middle of my, you know, of my shop. I have a small room that is about 12 square meters, and that is the entire shop, the entirety of the shop, and basically that is where I tie. So I have crammed a lot of stuff into into this place, and basically that's it. So. How I'm gonna build this is basically kind of like one of the uniform ways to building a nice and efficient pike fly when you're using a tube. I'm basically just applying some tying thread here, to make this to make a base for a lot of the other materials, so they will not have to slip on the tube. I know that white thread probably is not as good to watch, but the rest of the fly is gonna be black. I should probably have switched to black thread, but you know. It's not going to be that much of a bother. Then I'm going to take some bucktail, and basically what we're going to do is first I'm going to tie some bucktail. Then I'm going to use some big fly fiber, and then I'm going to use two different types of flesh. I'm going to use this. This is the Magnum Grizzly Flesh from Hedron. Superior and just in any way a cool product. This product actually does quite a lot of the same things as the Grizzly Hackles. It's just way way cheaper. And then I'm going to use some really powerful flesh. Also, this is the lateral scales. Then we're gonna do some marabou, and then finally some giant ostrich. Then to finish it off with a flyman head, and this is basically the fly. So it's not a very different one. Product place my tool rack. There is a lot of. I use a future fly thread here, but you know this is basically one long product placement video. If you have not seen my webshop, then I would like to show it to you here. So here you have a link to the section of my webshop that is only concerned with pike. But actually, if you think you like the format, you like how this is set up, then actually I have some full material kits that you can buy, where you can get the full material lists you need for three flies at a time. So if you like to follow the trout part of this session, then you can go onto my shop, you can click one time, and then you buy a complete set of material that will cover the next three flies, this fly for this evening, all materials for that, and for two more. And basically what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to build sessions of three flies at a time that has a lot of the materials in common so that you don't need to overbuy stuff. Simply to design these different packages so a lot of the materials will overlap, but you will get flies that does a lot of different things. For instance, in this part of the trout flying session, you'll get a dry fly, you'll get a nymph, and then a small goby pattern. Also the pike session, which is the one we're doing now, there is materials for two different pike flies. Both of them black, of course, because most of this is black. So there's materials for a nice popper and for this, and then I have that. Well, that's another kit, but I have a kit for the thing that's scheduled in 3 weeks, which is how to tie how to tie a rig for tube flies. So basically, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna try to create some easy options for you to follow these, because I'm gonna do this every single Friday at this time for into the future, because I really really think this is a cool format and I'm gonna do this. So if you want to join and tie along, the idea is that you easily and without paying too much can follow a course that takes three Fridays and of course you decide if you just want to tag along and drink some beer, you're very welcome to do that. But if you want to tie along, get some of the materials for the flies, then I really really would not. I would agree with you that would be a great idea. Well, cheers. I think I've talked too much now. Now I'm gonna tie some flies. So it's back to this. Okay, so basically, I added a lot of tying thread, and then I'm gonna take some of my bucktail here, and of course you want to get a bucktail that is fairly long, and I actually hand pick all the materials in my shop. So whenever I order some, let's say I order a bunch of bucktails from one of my distributors, I go over each and every pack, and if the quality is not up to standard, then I simply return the stuff that is not long enough, because I have a lot of pike tires buying stuff in my shop, because one of the things I think that really really is important is, especially if you're trying to if you want to sell fly tying materials online, is the level of quality is the most important thing there is, because basically you're trusting me with your money for buying materials that you do not have the option to have in your hands and to feel and to see the quality of. So I really really take the matter of quality very very seriously, because I have had some bad experiences myself, you know, with buying stuff online from different shops, shops that, well, maybe did not have the level of commitment or had the time, let's say that, had the time to actually select and be thorough when it came to quality, and it's simply just annoying to get something that is substandard. So I take great care and pride myself on that point to simply make sure that every single piece of every single item I sell is up to standard. It's something that I would pay the full price for myself. So what I did, I tied it so it pointed forward, and then I pushed it and pulled it and forced it backwards like this in order for this to make sure that this corona, this halo here, is gonna lift up all the other materials I'm gonna use. Then I'm gonna take some big fly fibers. Did I have some laying down here, or should I? I had some here. Big fly fiber is quite cool, because maybe I should move this a bit further back. Is that still okay? Yeah, I'm not drunk. I'm just adjusting the camera. Sorry. Like so. You can see it's getting a bit warm here. I have these two very very massive lights in order to make the lighting good here. So it's a bit hot here. That's also why I like the beer. So I take a bundle of this big fly fiber here,
Not too much. And then I tie this down all the way around, so I get as close to evenly distribute amount of materials all the way around here.
Why don't you brush the big fly fiber? Well, I could do that. I've never tried that. I just use it like this. With this. I just like it like this. Yeah, I use the white for everything, and the Well, Jim, right, I do ship to the US, but I don't know what you're asking about the US prices, because I have the prices in the shop, and my prices is in euros, and euros is a bit more it's a bit more than the dollar is, but not a lot. So you can basically just look at my shop in English, and if you find something you like, you can find the day-to-day exchange rate on the internet and look it up, or you can ask me. I can tell you. So basically, I have now tied the big fly fiber, and I cut off the big fly fiber here in front. That's basically one of the only materials I ever cut off. Then I take the Magnum Flashaboo here, and Magnum Flashaboo is just, well, one of those materials that has never been copied, that is impossible to make something as cool as this. Hedron really, really does an awesome and outstanding job making this, and these grizzly colors here are simply just cool, because it's a fairly easy and cheap way to make something that looks like grizzly hackles. So what I do is I take the ends here of this, and then I pull a bit on them so they're not completely uniform in length. And then I have, and the material here is 52 bloody centimeters long, which is very, very nice. And basically I take this again, and then I double it. Oh wait, do I double it? Should I do that? Yeah, I'm gonna do that. And then I double it in order to not have too much here. And then we're going to tie it down here, like so. Again, I'm going to use a lot of thread here to make sure it stays there. And basically, what I will do now is I'm going to cut off these as much as I can. Because then I can, if I cut the double ones off, then I can turn this over here, and I can add more flesh this way. So I will get a more bulky wing without having wasted too much flesh, like so. This one now, that's double. And of course, because flesh is quite slippery, I'm gonna take some Sabagap and apply some of those or some of that there to make sure that this will stay in place. Like that. So far, so good. Then I'm gonna take the lateral scales, which is an even wider flash, and this is the color Mirror Opal. And this is probably the most shiny material in the known universe. I'm tempted to say, and I simply take, and then I hold it like this, so it's spread out. I'm gonna do that close to the end of this, because then I can, in one go, simply get it almost evenly distributed all around the tube here, like so. And if it's not completely uniform, then I'm gonna simply just take some and move it a bit around till it's better, till it's where I want it, like so. This is going to be a bit of a stealthy fly, but I still want something that has a bit of a kick in it, and the lateral scales definitely has that effect, and also because of I used a lot of super glue, a lot of Sabagap before, then this flash will also be fast and quite good. Synthetic bucktail. I've never heard about that. Tie in half the bucktail fiber first, then the other half in front. It looks even bigger than. Okay, I'm gonna try that another time. Synthetic bucktail, never heard about that. The water where I fish for pike is very murky and the pike are really shy overfished. Yeah, Joshua Jungbr Joshua. If you're fishing waters where pike really has been very, very fished, then often what I find is a good combination, is something that's very good, is small and black. Try to fish something that is different from what everyone else has fished. And if these fish you're talking about have not seen a wriggle tail, then the wriggle tails really, really can do a can make an awesome, awesome difference. So try something that people have not tried before. And if wriggle tails is not something that your fish has seen, then definitely do that. That will make an impact. And then go smaller than what anyone else does. But I know firsthand of the problem with having waters that has been fished a lot, and the pikes simply they seem to you know, almost overnight to simply know that something that swims and shimmers swims slow and shimmers quite a lot is not food. They just seem to know it. Oh well, let's continue tying here. So basically, I have all of this now. And what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna take some of this big ostrich here. Is that now? Yeah, it's now. I'm gonna take some of this big ostrich. I would say 10, 15, something like that. And this ostrich really, really is awesome. It's quite hard to come by, and I've contacted 20 plus suppliers around a lot of different places to get good quality of long ostrich, and finally I found a place. But the problem is I have to buy 100 feathers of each colors, and that's simply too much for my small shop to bear that kind of investment. So I buy a color at a time, and that means that often I do not have all the colors I would like in stock. And right now I have the two best ones, the two I use the most, the black and the chartreuse. Basically what I've done is I've taken this all these ostrich feathers here, plumes here, and then again I'm gonna tie these so they're pointing forward. So I'm gonna try to have these distributed again as evenly as I can all the way around the tube here, like so. Really gonna do like that and clamp down, really tie down here, use some force. So now they're pointing forward, and just to make it a bit more bulky up here in the head part, I'm gonna take a marabou feather and turn that as a hackle. If I can find the right one. I have a lot lying here, but some of these are not very good. This one is good. I'm gonna tie this down in the tip of the feather here. Just gonna leave all of that there. So I'm tying this down here in the tip, like so. Not gonna cut this stuff off there either. And then simply here, I'm gonna tie this marabou feather. I'm gonna turn this marabou feather in order to give it some more bulk and some more liveliness movement here in the front of the fly here, like this. And all of this is going to be covered by the fish mask, so basically there's nothing to worry about. It's just to, you know, tie away. And I know how this looks. This looks like madness, and well, basically it is. But it's madness that really, really works. Gonna cut off this feather here, like so. And basically now I'm gonna do a whip finish in between here. So I do a whip finish with my fingers. You can do it, of course, with your whip finish tool, like that. And there's no need for varnish or anything, because all of this is gonna be covered completely by the flyman head. So basically what you have is something that looks quite insane. I think I can do like this. So you have all the ostrich sticking out here, you have the marabou hackle, and you have the rest of the fly pointing backwards here, like so. Could you send me, Miko, could you send me a link to that material after? I would like to see that. Don't forget to don't forget to drink your beer. Well, cheers, everyone. It was getting a bit warm because of all the lights here. It's just, you know, the temperature here is just insane. Skål. Okay. So the last finishing touch here is of course getting some eyes and a head on this bugger. And I really really like these I really really like these Flyman heads here. They're easy to use and works very well, but it's important that you have a lot of materials here in front of on the head of the fly. Otherwise, this will not be filled with materials. It will there will be some air in there, and that can make your fly swim very high in the water unless you're using a sinking line. So if you are having troubles with getting this down, then use a sinking line. What I like to I like this fly because it really has a nice a nice what do you call it? It kind of like hovers in the waters. So it really has a very erratic movement. It swims out to one side and then to the other side and back, kind of like a jerk bait. And when you stops when you stop stripping, it actually just hangs there pulsating in the water. And very often one of the things that really really pikes can't resist, it's not while you're stripping very often that they take the fly. It's when your fly is basically just hanging in the water. I've seen it countless times when fishing that a pike follows the flies very very long, and when you cannot strip anymore and you simply just let it hang there, literally let it hang there in the water for 1, 2, 3, 4 seconds, something like that, then all of a sudden bang, it comes and grabs it. So yeah. Basically, it's a nice if you can get that hover effect, that's really really cool. So what I do is I take this head here and then simply just take it and make that head turn all the stuff backwards. Of course, making sure nothing gets in the way, like so. Gonna help this a bit because some of this stuff got stuck. Like so. And basically, there you have it. Let's see here. Yeah. So now I need to take some more glue. Where is the glue? There's always that glue that gets away. Oh, there it is. I'm gonna take some glue here. You can use UV glue as well, but I find that this Sabergap works quite well. I think if you really want to be on the safe side, use some UV glue on top here, and then basically just put an eye there. I like these frantic eyes, and I have quite a good price on these eyes. They're 2 euro for a sheet like this, and really really they're cool looking. I have a lot of different eyes on the web shop, like so, and basically now you can of course if you really, what you probably should do is take your tying thread and just make a head out here in front, to make sure that the head stays on there. Yeah, I'm gonna do that. But this is white, so you know, yes, you probably should have taken a black thread or something like that. You can also simply just press it backwards and use some glue and stuff like that. I'm gonna do that instead. This looks stupid. Like so. Just gonna take that off and then simply just smear glue on this here. I think that would cover it. I'm taking my head here. And now I'm stuck. God damn it. Just gonna gently cut myself loose. Like that. So basically, there you have it. I'm gonna cut off the tube here in front. Not all of it. I'm gonna leave a bit out there
And then I'm simply just gonna take my lighter here. Then I'm gonna make this curl back. Like so. And there you go. I'm coming for you. Regretfully, I was hoping to go pike fishing this weekend, but no luck. So tomorrow morning, well, I should not complain. Tomorrow morning, I'm going sea trout fishing instead. And I just wanted to show you this. This is how you a way to attach this is simply, you know, have this back here, and then you have the wriggle tails. And the wriggle tails here is just simply just sweet, cool stuff. That really works well, and this is how I would fish this fly. I also like the rattle here, and these new Arix light stinger hooks is just awesome. And well, basically I can't show you. This was the box I was going pike fly fishing with, and as you can see, I have most of the color I have the most of is the black. It has a completely different compartment for itself, and well, basically I can see the time is up now. The hour has come and gone, but I think I will continue to keep this going a bit more. If you have some questions, then I would like to answer them. Don't take the Lord's name in vain. I'm sorry if I offended anyone. I didn't mean anything by it, but you know, it must be my poor English. Who's Gripen? Yes, of course. Like, I will remember the ribbing. Took a look at Chasing Silver website. Cool stuff there. The CFC Predator blend brushes looks great too. Yeah. Aqua Sure for waders is the best glue for eyes on pro soft test. You're probably right about that, Adam, as well. Sure, I'll PM you. Apparently, you can't link stuff on a live stream. Well, regarding that, I'm the only one that can do links. That's also why there is a crown next to my name whenever I write something in the chat. I think that's actually hilarious. But what I was saying is when you fish these pike flies, especially here in the winter time, I find that that when you're retrieving and stuff like that, most important is the speed of at which you retrieve. Because I actually have a lot of experience with pikes, and I've caught quite a lot of nice and decent sized pikes as well. And I really love pike, and yeah, it's one of my really nice. One of the fish I like to target the most. This year has not been as much because I've had a kind of like a crush on salmon, so I've been doing that for quite a lot this year. But otherwise, pike is something I'm definitely going to go back to and do a lot more next year probably. But the slow retrieve is really important, and I must say I normally joke that when I fish for pike, I have two different speeds. I have very slow, and then I have very ultra slow, and that's the two paces I use. Because I've actually not experienced many times that you know, full throttle is something that works. Almost all other fish I fish full throttle. When I fish sea trout, when I fish salmon, when I fish, you know, the times I've been doing tropical saltwater, it's always been with the rod under the arm and then just, you know, hammering away. But with pikes, I find that slow is way better. And having the flies hover hanging there is really something that is cool. No, Addis, I'm not live streaming every night. I'm live streaming two nights in the week, Thursday and Friday, because I have Friday off. I'm a school teacher, so but this year, in order to do something more about the shop, I've taken a bit more time off from teaching, so I have time to do something like this. That's why I don't work in the school on Fridays, so I have time to prepare something like this. And I must say I'm enjoying these. And there are going to be a lot more of these. And as I said before, every single Friday, this is something that I'm going to do. And it's going to be the same way as it was this evening. Me ranting a lot, and hopefully you telling me and asking me a lot of questions. And then of course divided into two parts: a trout part and a perch slash
pike slash muskie slash, yeah, maybe saltwater, I don't know, something like that. Yeah, Mike, you can easily use use this pattern on a hook. You definitely can. But make sure if you're using the Flyman heads, when you're using those on hooks. Let me just see if I can locate where I had it. The Flyman heads here. When you're using them and you're using them on hooks, then do not go above the size 8 millimeters, because it will take up a lot of space with the hook bend. So if you use these, for instance, these 10 millimeters, then a lot of the hook gape will be lost to the head. So if you're tying these on, let's say, a 4.0 hook, then definitely no problem at all, do that, but make sure that you have either a very large hook or you do not exceed the Flyman fish heads here in size 8 millimeters. Fly for sea bass, please. Oh, I have one for sea bass. A very, very nice one for sea bass. I'm gonna link you one. Actually, the one I have for sea bass here is something that I actually caught 42 sea bass on this on one trip. The only trip I had fishing for sea bass this year, and I just hammered it. I just completely hit, you know, the mother load, really, really, truly the mother load. I found that for sea bass, then it's really nice to fish with. You can see here, if the link doesn't work, simply copy paste it. There is a nice fly for sea bass. I thought that sand eels flies are very, very great for fishing sea bass. Pedro, about colors, is that for pike? If it's for pike, then I would say that my best color of all is black. Then black, then red and white. Red and white is something that really, really works well. Then pink and chartreuse, and orange. Pink and chartreuse is the third best option, and both of those are very, fairly good, especially in waters that has not been fished too much. Then they can outfish a lot of other stuff. But black, widen red, and then pink chartreuse and orange is a fire tiger combination can really, really be deadly. Pink and pearl. Ah, okay. Well, basically, one last thing. If you really would like to, if you would like to see more about these live streams and be able to influence what type of patterns that I will be tying, then I have made a group. That's where I'm gonna ask in this group exactly what patterns and what type of fish and a lot of different stuff you would like to see. So basically, join that group. I've just linked it in the chat here. Join that group and you can have influence. You can help decide how until and help make these live streams better. So join there if you like. Otherwise, I simply would like to say I think I would like to say thank you all for tuning in. This really means a lot to me, and I hope to see you a lot more in the future, because I had fun. I had a beer, tied some flies that I definitely will be using over this winter. Maybe not the nymph, but you know. Yeah, basically, thank you a lot, and I hope to see you again next Friday, to have a beer with me and tie a fly if you like. So I think that's it, and I'm signing off now. So thank you for watching, and have a nice weekend.